Investors here today. I see a lot of faces I haven't seen here before. I see a family sitting over here. Pleased to have you folks here. Anybody else visiting today? Hey. Check it.
Okay. Let's turn to page 57.
So sweet to trust in Jesus just to pass.
Okay. Let's turn over to page 167.
Thank you. sleepy this morning. Okay, just wake up. Wake up. This morning. Now everybody's yawning. This morning, I brought... It makes my mouth water just to look at those apples, doesn't it, you? They look so good, I could just take a big old bite out of them. Now, how many of you, hold them up so they can see, look at them carefully. How many of you think this is the real apple? How many of you think this one is the real apple? How many don't think? How many of you don't think? Let's ask again. Who thinks this is a real apple? Okay. Who thinks that's a real apple? You want to change your mind? Everybody wants to change their mind?
No.
Okay. So if you said this one, that is the real apple. If you said this one, this is the fake apple. Okay? So, this one is an imitation. Okay, I know there's a lot of activity up here. Okay?
I'm just walking around.
Okay, so this one is an imitation. It's artificial. It's fake, isn't it, boys and girls? But this one is real, and it's juicy, and I bet when you bite into it, I can just taste it already. Now, boys and girls, we have a real apple and a fake apple. We have a real apple and an artificial apple. Now, I want you to listen to me. Everybody look this way. I want you to hear what I have to say, okay? Because this is really important for y'all. Not because I've said it, but because this is what's happening in our world today. There have been people that have started preaching, God is the sun. God is the moon. God is the trees and the flowers and the grass. There have been people that have started preaching, if you work hard, you'll go to heaven. People have started preaching, if you give enough money to your church, you can buy your way into heaven. There have been people that said, if you love God, you will never be sick. I've heard that one a lot in my life. I've heard it a lot in my life. Okay, I'm going to get through this. I know I am, okay? If you love God, you'll never be sick. And if you follow God, he will make you rich. Are any of those things true?
No,
they're not. They are just like that piece of fake fruit. They're just like that fake apple. They are not real. They can't promise you anything because they are not from God. And they are lying when they say these things. The Bible tells us that Jesus is the truth. He is the way and the life. He is our truth. And he's like this piece of real fruit. He is not fake. He's not artificial. And he's not an imitation. What he says, boys and girls, he'll do. If God makes a promise, where do you find his promises? Yes, if he makes a promise, you better believe that he's going to keep it. I am an old woman, and I have never known God to break a promise to me. You can trust him. If he says it, he's going to do it. When God says, if you will ask me into your heart and ask me to forgive all the mess in your life and follow me, I will take you to heaven with me one day so that you can live with me forever. When he says, I will forgive you, when you know you've done something wrong, I will forgive you. All you need to do is ask. If he makes a promise, boys and girls, he's going to keep it. And just like this fake apple up here, he can't do anything for you but sit and look pretty. It's the same way with these people who are telling lies about God. They can't do anything for you either because they are fake. They are imitators and they are artificial and they are not from God. So this is what I want you to hear. You be careful. You be careful when people start telling you things like this. Oh, be a Christian, you'll never be sick. Oh, give enough money to your church and you'll get to heaven. Oh, this and oh, that. If you question anything, you go to mom and dad and have them pull out this Bible and you have them look it up and tell you if that's true or not. It's so important, boys and girls, that Satan is alive today. Mm-hmm. And he walks around this earth looking to steal, kill, and destroy.
Amen.
And he will get a hold of you before you even know what has happened. So it's important for us as Christians to keep our eyes and our mind and our heart focused on God, or these liars will come in and we'll believe them. We'll believe them because they sound so good and they look so good. That's Satan, boys and girls, and you need to know the difference. So you be very careful when people start talking to you that you're listening to the truth, okay?
Amen.
Boys and girls, it is my prayer for you that you have a relationship with God, that you come to know him, and you're so close to him, and you hear his voice, and you look to him for everything that you need. And if you'll keep your eyes on God, focused on God, you can't go wrong.
Amen.
You cannot go wrong. And I'm an old lady, and I'm telling you right now, life is hard. Life is hard, and things will happen to you that you never dreamed in a million years would come along. And if you don't have God, you're going to start listening to the liars. So you stand strong. You know what's right. You know what God says. If you don't, get out your Bible. Let's pray. Father God, we just thank you for this day, Lord, and we thank you for each person that is here today. Father, we thank you that you are the truth and the way. God, we thank you that you love us so much that you sent your son to die for us, Father. I pray that you would help us to be aware of what's happening in the world. I pray that you would help us to listen to what people are preaching, that you would help us to know when we are listening to liars and that we would walk away from them, Lord. Keep these children protected, Father. I pray that you would walk with them every day at school and just keep them safe. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good job. Grace. Good job sitting there. Lovely lady. Thank you.
Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries today?
Thank you. turning your Bibles to Matthew chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11. I'm sure many have read this chapter in certain ways, for sure, and you've probably for sure read these last few verses that we're mainly going to be looking at today. But there's a lot to this chapter that fits in. To understand those five or six verses at the end, we have grasped the whole chapter. So although I'm not going to read it all, we'll be looking at the whole chapter. But before we look at that, I want to talk a little bit about this rest. Rest for the weary. Look at this picture that I have up there. I know it's kind of hard to see right now. It's dark. But you can tell it's a mountain scenery. Nice, calm, peaceful area. That right there is an area where I would like to be. I love the mountains. That's where I find peace. That's where I find rest. That's where I find joy in a lot of ways, is the comfort through the mountains. But the thing is, the mountains are nothing compared to Christ. The mountains are nothing compared to the rest that Jesus Christ offers each and every one of us today. And the rest he offers is an offer of spiritual rest. But he also tells us about a physical rest that we need. It's much like this story in this Greek legend from Athens, where this man noticed Aesop. Everybody knows Aesop's fables, right? Well, he notices Aesop playing childish games with some of the boys of the town. And this man laughed at him and jeered at Aesop, asking him why he wasted his time in such frivolous activity. Well, Aesop responded by picking up a bow and loosening its string and placing it on the ground. Then he looked at the Athenian and he said, "Now answer the riddle. If you can answer this, tell us what the unstrung bow implies." The man looked at it for several minutes but had no idea what it was. He had no clue. He couldn't figure it out what point Aesop was trying to make. So Aesop explained, "If you keep a bow always bent, it will break eventually. But if you let it go slack, it'll be more fit for use when you want it." People are just like that too. That's where we all need to take some time to rest. If we're always bent, we'll break. If we're always under a burden, we'll falter. If we're always trying to complete something without getting any kind of break, we will fail. There has to be some point of rest at some point in your life, physical, mental, and spiritual. God the Father created all of this in 6 days, and on the seventh, he what? Rested. We read in Hebrews where Christ talks about the Israelites failed to enter into his rest because they failed to be obedient, they failed to follow, but this rest is still offered. Rest is crucial. We all too often have a tendency in our lives to look at life, to look at everything as a path of nothing but work. Just as Kathy talked a second ago to the kids about how people try to earn their way to Christ. This world pushes that to a degree. We have a tendency to think that we have to work for everything we get. That's why it's so difficult for man to accept the free gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, because we, in our brains, we get to thinking we're smarter than God and we need to do something for that salvation. And that is incorrect. And that's what we see a lot in the scripture today. This section of scripture where Christ is laying these woes out to Chorazin and these woes out to Capernaum and all of these woes being poured out to these other cities because they thought they knew more. The Pharisees thought they knew more. The scribes thought they knew more. Intellectuals today think they know more. Atheists always try to tell us that there is no God. Come on, you just look around, you see there is no God. There's nothing behind all of this. You just got a crutch to lean on. And as a post I saw the other day, well, maybe I do have a crutch, but atheists would walk around on a broken leg saying you don't need help. We need that rest. We need it. And as we'll see in a second, why? But I want you to look. And I want you to know that there is rest. There is rest. There must be rest. There has to be rest. Rest is ingrained in the system. Why do you think you have to sleep? God created us that way. We have to rest. We have to. I don't know how long anybody, the longest anybody here's ever stayed up, but I know I stayed up for over 40 hours straight a couple different times on a work oil field, and I mean to tell you, by the time I finally found a bed, I was a walking zombie. When you're awake for nearly 48 hours straight, working the majority of that time, your body starts doing crazy things. You start seeing crazy things. You see dogs with something riding them running across the road that there's not there. You see elephants, you see these things, you see stuff. And this is without any kind of drug or alcohol involved. They're just straight up work and labor. You start seeing things, it gets tough. Kind of like in the movie, 13 Hours and Benghazi, when the guy's up there on the roof and he's sitting there, he's like, man, there's one over there. Another guy's looking, like, there's nobody there. You need to go rest. It's the same thing with us. We need to rest. Because we too often start seeing things that aren't there when we're not rested right. So let's see what Christ tells us here. And he says, at that time Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. That this whole chapter, Matthew 11, is one of the greatest chapters in the Gospel of Matthew, I think. Because it gives us a lot of understanding. Because at the very beginning of it, we see John the Baptist. All right? That's why I wanted to open to 11, because I don't have all the scriptures up here, but we're going to look at some of these. At the very beginning of it, we see John the Baptist in prison because he's been preaching about Christ and doing all these things, sharing Christ, and Herod wanted him in there because he condemned Herod for stealing his brother's wife and all of these things, and Herod had him arrested. So there he was in prison, and he sends his disciples to Jesus and to ask him, are you the Messiah to come, or are we looking for another? Think about it, if you will. Just think about John the Baptist, what he saw. Right? When he was there at the Jordan River and his camel hair and eating his honey and his locusts, hanging out in the wild, being a wild man, and Christ come, when he was out there talking to these people, what did he tell them? They were like, are you him? He said, no, I am not. I am not the Messiah. He said, but there is one who comes, who was before me, but comes after me, that I am not even worthy to untie his sandal. And then Christ comes, and he looks at him and says, you should be baptizing me. But Jesus says, no, you were to baptize me. So John baptizes him, and what does he hear? What does he see when this happens? What is going on after that? He is standing there, and he hears the booming voice of God the Father from heaven say, this is my Son with whom I am well pleased. And the Spirit descended upon him. John saw all of that, every bit of it. He knew Jesus was the Messiah. So here's the thing that gives us some hope, though, because John knew that. And Christ says right here that he was the greatest, born of women. None are greater than him. None are greater than him, and John had questions. But here's the thing, there's a difference between him and the Pharisees and these cities here in a second, we'll see. See, John, in humility, was asking. He wanted absolute confirmation. And that is perfectly fine. We can do the same thing. We need to do the same thing sometimes. And how we do that sometimes is by saying, God, I can't do this. I need you. And you stop. And you rest. And you let Jesus take over. You stop trying to fight the battle. You let Jesus fight the battle. You stop trying to stand up and do what needs to be done, going, I can't fix this. Let Jesus do it. But you've got to step out there and say, I want to know, are you God? Show me, just as Moses did, Exodus 34, show me your face. God said, I can't show you my face, but you can see my back. We sometimes need to ask that question and just rest in his embrace. See, John wanted to do it. He asked, and Jesus says here, he's like, tell him, the lame are being healed, the dead are being raised, all of these miracles are being performed. See, in Luke chapter 7, we see where Jesus does that immediately after. He doesn't even say a word. He just heals and does these things and tells them, now go. Go tell John what you saw. So questioning and having doubts is fine. John was in a bad spot. Maybe you're in a bad spot. Maybe you're in a tight spot. Maybe you're in a struggling spot. And you're wondering, Jesus, are you real? Are you really there? It's okay to ask and rest and wait on him to answer. Quit fighting so hard and let Christ do the work. But accept it when it comes. Accept it when he shows. Because as we see here, it goes on and it talks, and all this condemnation is said because they're like, they're like the children sitting in the marketplaces and playing. They were playmates, and I played our flute for you, but you did not dance. We sang a dirge, and you did not mourn. This is in verses 16 and 17. It says, for John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking. They say, look, him, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Don't be that way. Don't try to fit Jesus into your box and make him be something he is not. See, that's our biggest problem. That's where we get hung up a lot of times. Instead of just resting in who he is, we try to make him be someone he's not. We try to say, just as Kathy told the kids, it's perfect how she fit that in, and we didn't even talk about these messages, but it ties so well because people are like, Jesus, you're supposed to heal me. It says here, by your stripes we are healed. Sorry, that's spiritual healing, not physical. People want that. People are like, you're supposed to bless us with all blessings of the heavenly blessings. We're supposed to have all this wealth and all this glory. No, that is not material. That is spiritual. We try to force Christ into this mold, just as these people did, and they rejected. John is in prison, and he's just like, hey, are you him? I need to know, because I'm in a bad spot. Or am I supposed to look for another? And Jesus says, yes. Rest in him. But don't be like these cities that are proud and arrogant, as we see. He says, woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago and sackcloth and ashes. Right. They're self-righteous cities. They've seen these miracles. They saw Jesus working. They saw all these things. They took up stones to stone him. They pushed him out. They condemned him. They hated him. They were against him. And he's laying this condemnation on them because of their self-righteousness. We know better. We know more. Who are you? They've put him in this box. Our Messiah is going to come in and destroy Rome. What are you doing? You're not him, is what they're saying. And Tyre and Sidon are cities that were full of wickedness and evil. They were pagans. They were false god worshipers. They were all about Baal. They were all about all that. They went that way. And Christ is saying, they would have repented had they saw you. They would have turned. They would have changed had they seen what you have seen. Yet you're rejected. Think, if you will, Luke chapter 16, the rich man and Lazarus. When the rich man dies and goes to hell, and he's down there in suffering and torment, and he looks up and he sees Lazarus with Abraham, and he's talking to him, trying to get all of the stuff, and he says, send him back so my brothers don't wind up in this spot. What does Abraham say? Abraham tells him, even if a man was to rise from the dead and go to them, they would not repent. What he's talking about is the same thing right here. These great signs. All the Pharisees and all these people are seeking these signs and wanting these signs and wanting these wonders. Even if you see them, you're not going to change. It takes a heart change. It takes Christ working on you. It takes this call that we see in verses 25 through 30, where Christ is calling out to all who are weary, all who are heavy laden, all who are burdened, all who need me. Here it is. Come to me. These signs won't do it. And Capernaum, his hometown, Christ's own hometown. That's where he took up residence. Tell you, they rejected him. And he says, the judgment will be more tolerable for Sodom than you. What happened to Sodom? Brimstone and fire rained down on them. They were totally destroyed. And Christ is telling Capernaum, because of their rejection of him, because they knew better. They put him in a box. He was not the Messiah to come. He's not the Messiah they wanted. He's not the Messiah they said they need. He's not the one. He doesn't fit the mold that there's going to be more tolerable or solid than them. Arrogance and pride are the problems that hold us back. Arrogance and pride are the problems that stop us from going to Christ for that rest. Arrogance and pride is what stopped these. Arrogance and pride is what caused the Pharisees to add and lump and pile more and more and more on the law of Moses and telling people, you need to do this, you must do this, you have to do this work, you have to do this work, you have to work, 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 work to get this. That guy over there that's offering it to you freely right now that's doing these miracles, that is not him. That is not the Messiah. Here, look, right here in our Talmud, it says you must do this. Look, back in the law of Moses, it says you must do this. Look, we have people today telling us the same thing. Jesus is freely offering it. It's yours. But people are saying, no, that's not right. You can't be. No. That is a bigoted and hateful man. That is a bigoted and hateful deal. It's not him. Here's what it is. It's some of that mixed with this over here. For his love is love, they say. There's a rejection that's still going. Are we going to let that happen, or are we going to enter the rest of Christ and let Christ take us? That is the question we have to ask. Because Christ is the one, and all these arrogant and all these prideful and all of these foolish people are missing the mark, even though they're wise and understanding. They're missing it because they're not childlike. That's the thing. We've got to be childlike. What's a kid like? You tell them something, what do they do? They believe you. You tell them the biggest Wild West tale you ever even thought of, and they're going to believe you. They may kind of question, but they're going to believe until they're told different, up to a certain age. Then they know it all. They're like these towns that get destroyed. They know it all. They become wise and understanding. And then they become childlike again, hopefully. But that's the thing. We need to be childlike. See, Christ is praying the Father. I thank you that you have hidden these from those wise and understanding, that they're missing it. Because pride and arrogance needs punishment. It needs to be knocked to their knees. Now, there may be some of these people in these towns, some of these wise and understanding, some of these arrogant, we see them come to faith. Look at Paul. He was wise and understanding, prideful and arrogant. He saw the light, literally, and it blinded him, and he came to faith. But the thing is, you've got to be childlike and have faith and trust Christ. We've got to do that. Instead of letting everybody lump things on us and tell us to do all of these things, we've got John the Baptist to have that curiosity and continue to see Christ, continue to want Christ, continue to look out to him and cry out to him and seek that rest that he offers. See, some will try to put this as an election, that God is doing all of these things and saying it's only these people, certain people, this group here that are predestined to salvation. But I believe this text blows that out when Christ says, all things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one can come unless I call. And then we see his call. Come to me, all who labor. Come to me, all who are weary. Come to me, all of you who need this rest. And I'm going to tell you right now, every one of us are weary. Every one of us are worn down. Every one of us are beaten black and blue because of the wickedness that's going on in the world, because of the way, we just look at life in general, how the economy is horrible. We're struggling to make ends meet. We're having these battles. We're seeing all this stuff going on. We're trying to raise our kids in it, and we're trying to protect them and shelter them. We're trying to raise them with good values where they're good human beings when they grow up and they go out and they live right and they do right and they work for a living. They earn their own keep. They're not just out there being bums. We're trying to do all of this, and the world is knocking and fighting and beating and challenging. We're all weary. Not one of us is not. I'm telling you, I'm tired. But I'm tired because I keep fighting the fight with Christ, and I'm letting him lead the charge. And I'm tired. And I know you're tired too. This world is hard, is it not? This world is not peaceful. This world is not comforting. This world is not our home. Amen? Let us focus on Christ on this, because he is who's going to give us rest, and he is calling you if you are burdened and weary And I want to tell you, we see the heart of Christ revealed in this next section. This is the only section of Scripture that says what his heart is. I am gentle and lowly in heart. It's a beautiful thing. We see this here. And he tells us in three words, come. Invitation. Come. Come. You're invited. Here, take this. Take this. This is mine. Take it upon you. Take mine upon you and learn from me. Come, take, and learn of the words we see here. And it's followed up with a very powerful word that we need to allow to soak into the marrow of our bones. Rest. Come, take, and learn. Come to me. Rest. Take my yoke, which is easy, and learn my rest. It's all about rest in Christ. Now, I want to say, a yoke is a heavy wooden harness that fits over a team of oxen fixed to something to pull. It's a work utensil, right? We all know what a yoke is, I assume. I hope. If not, just picture it's a heavy wooden thing. You put them on, and boom, it drapes over their neck. And they pull a wagon. It's work. So you may be, wait a minute. Hey, whoa. If I'm to rest, how in the world is a yoke rest? How is a yoke rest? It's Christ's yoke. When you yoke up to Christ, when you get in that yoke beside him, do you think you're actually carrying anything? Christ is bearing the burden. How did I know this? What did he do for you? He came. He came from heaven, took on flesh, went to the cross. Before the cross, he was beaten, he was mocked, he was scorned, he was ridiculed, he had a crown of thorns put on his head. He had all of this. He humbled himself, as Paul says, humbled himself to the point of death, even death on a cross for you. Do you think that he's going to force you to bear the yoke? Or is he going to bear it for you? Well, he says, come, and I will give you rest. Come, all who are weary. Come to me. Now, he's going to come. He's going to bring you in, and he's going to yoke up beside you, and he's going to carry that burden. And you want to know what that burden carrying looks like? That looks like we're his. We're eternally there. We go and share his amazing message of salvation to the world, as he tells us in the 28th chapter of his second gospel. Go, make disciples. You know what happens when we let him bear the burden? We take it and share it and deliver the message and let the Spirit do his work. If people mock and scorn, they're not mocking and scorning us. They're mocking and scorning him. If people accept it, they believed in Jesus Christ, not us. We don't save anybody. And I remember growing up in youth in the 90s where we had boards with names. You'd write names of friends on, and your goal was to go out and share the gospel with them and come back in and check them off after they prayed a prayer and got saved. You know what all that did was put a burden on you to try to be the one. It forced more pain, more suffering, just as the burdens that the Pharisees piled on people, as we read in Matthew 23:4. How they tie up heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on people's shoulders. But they themselves are not willing to move them with their finger. People want to burden us. We see those burdens. But here's the thing, we don't need a board. We don't need a name. What we do is go out there and you find somebody and you're like, hey, Jesus Christ died for you. Are you tired? Are you beat down? Are you worn out? Are you weary? Are you lonely? Well, let me tell you about him. And either they believe it or they reject it. But it's not on us to save them. We just take it. And we rest in Christ to bear that burden. That's what he does. That's what he's telling us. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. We learn from him. What did he do? These people would come to him. What did Christ do? They would start in on questions, and he would just ask them questions back. Made them think. Made them understand. But he didn't force. He didn't demand. He didn't any of that stuff. Right here we see him laying these woes out. But these woes sometimes we look at as more of an anger, but it's a heartache. When you study it, look at it, it's a grief. He is upset. It's just like when he weeps over Jerusalem for rejecting him. He's like, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, those of you who have rejected the prophets and you've rejected. Why? That's what it is. That's what we learn. And we stay faithful to him. See, when we learn from him and we stay obedient to him, we stay in that yoke and he bears the weight. But anytime we start thinking we know and start veering off, we start bearing that burden. We start carrying a 400-pound pack that you're not meant to carry. And I'm telling you, if you go to my workouts, I will go out and I will put on a 30 or 40-pound weighted vest and a backpack with 10, 20 pounds extra in it, and I will fire out and jog for four miles. And I want to tell you, by the time I make it to the house, that burden that I'm carrying is just about all I can carry. And it wears me down. That's the same kind of burdens you're carrying today if you're trying to pack all this stuff without Christ. If you're not in his rest and in his yoke with him, you're bearing it all. And I'm telling you, you will go down. You will go down. Don't try to bear it on your own. Don't think you know everything. Drop that pride and arrogance and look to Christ and be like John the Baptist and say, I don't know. Help me. I can't do it. Help me. And I'm telling you, Christ will be right there. He will be there for you. And as Dane Ortlund wrote in the book, Gentle and Lowly, which I have a whole bunch of them if anybody wants any after this sermon, the wonderful book. Here up there it says, his yoke is kind and his burden is light. That is, his yoke is a non-yoke and his burden is a non-burden. And he illustrates it this way. He says, what helium does to a balloon, Jesus' yoke does to his followers. We are buoyed along in life by his endless gentleness and supremely accessible lowliness. Like helium to a balloon is what Jesus' yoke for us does. It carries us along. So in this overworked, underrested world, know that that yoke is yours. Know that you can take that rest. Know that just like I said, the mountains that I love to hang out in, that I find good rest and peace in, nothing compared to this yoke of Jesus Christ. So when you find yourself burdened, what do you do? Christ, I can't do it. When you find yourself weary, what do? Christ, I need you. When you find yourself heavy laden and going down, Christ, take this from me. I can't do it. Because we've strayed from his yoke. We've put ourselves in our own yoke. We've put ourselves in a burden we can't carry. Focus on Christ. Go back to Christ. Look to Christ. Rest in him. And don't let the world taking. Be like this man who's involved in the North American Mission Board, NAM, for short. He was in the missions in the early 2000s, and he went to the SBC convention to share what was going on and hoping others would get on board and help fund the missions. Scraped together enough money to get from Canada, where he was at, to New Orleans, where the convention was. And he took what he thought was enough cash for food, because he'd already got himself set up on how to get there and work stuff, but he didn't have enough money. He said when he got to New Orleans, it cost a whole lot more than he thought. So there he was on Tuesday afternoon, staying on the street corner with enough money to buy a Diet Coke and a candy bar, and he had to have enough to eat until Friday. He didn't know what to do. He was in a tight spot. He was already staying in a room that somebody else was paying for. He was nervous about asking, but because he trusts Christ and knew the faithfulness of Christ, he humbled himself and went and told some of his fellow brothers in Christ there at the convention what his situation was, and they took care of him. He trusted Christ and was humble enough to ask for help, and help was given. So that's what this section of Scripture is asking us. It's asking you to be humble enough to ask Christ for help. To look to Christ to save you, not only eternally, because he will save you eternally, but also from all things happening now. To give you that peace, to give you that rest, to give you that comfort, to face the challenges ahead of you. If you're not rested up, you will falter. If you're constantly bent like a bow, as Aesop said, it will break. If you're constantly under a burden, you will falter. You can't do it all. You can't carry everything. But I know the one who can. And he is the one we give it to, because once we give it to him, you can have rest. So today, let Christ yoke up with you. Let his yoke carry your burdens. And today, find your rest. Find that rest. And a wayward son or daughter, let Christ take it. You got bills you're struggling to pay, cry out to Christ. Humble yourself. Seek his faithful Father. You're hurting and grieving, let Christ carry that burden. Quit trying to carry it on your own. Because I'm telling you today, you can have rest in Jesus Christ. He's the only place where there is true rest. It is nowhere else to be found. No, only in Christ. If you're needing rest and you're wanting more, I will be at the back and I will talk with you, pray with you, whatever you need. Please, don't walk out of here today thinking you have burdens you have to carry that Christ has already died for. Cody, will you close us with prayer?